Good morning. I'd like to welcome you here to Bedlington Salvation Army, our online worship. It's so good to have you here with us this morning. And our theme for this morning's worship is how God is going to use you and how he used Moses. He used Moses with just a rod in his hand, and how he can use you with what you have. Each one of us has different talents, different gifts, and who knows how God is going to use you. And we're going to find that out today as Randy speaks later in the meeting. We're going to find out what he has to say about that. So get your cuppa and get into your position of worship, and let's just gather together and worship today and just get in to worship together and just learn a little bit more about how God can use us in our lives to just worship him and to be together. And also don't forget that we are going to be coming together to worship on September 6th. And so if you want to be a part of that, watch for the slide at the end of our meeting today, and that will give a little bit more detail on that. So now let's come together and worship in our service today.
Exodus chapter 4, verse 1 to 5. Moses answered, "What if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, 'The Lord did not appear to you'?" Then the Lord said to him, "What is that in your hand?" "A staff," he replied. The Lord said, "Throw it on the ground." Moses threw it on the ground and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, "Reach out your hand and take it by the tail." So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake, and it turned back into a staff in his hand. "This," said the Lord, "is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you."
And welcome to these few moments of joining together in prayer. It's a time when we can adjust and align our thoughts and feelings with those of God, our Heavenly Father. He knows all about the fears, the worries, and feelings of doubt that are abundant at the moment, and he bids us each to have courage, confidence, and perseverance, putting in our trust in him to carry us through these troubled times. Shall we pray?
Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you as a family and individuals, knowing you keep watch over us and caring continually to make sure we are safe in your love. When difficulties and challenges seem overwhelming, we know that if we trust and depend on you, your providential care will carry us through. We know that you will give us the strength we need to endure the hardships that life throws our way. So teach us to focus on you alone, so we can find full confidence in your mighty power. So bless us this morning and give us each a renewed determination to fully trust the promises you have given us and to be courageous in following your word. We ask all these things in and for your dear name's sake. Amen.
Thank you. Hey everybody, I wanted to show you what our building is going to look like when we resume meetings back on the building. And August 19, we're having a prayer meeting here. That'll be the first time that we can resume something on the building. And then September 6, we're starting up worship services here on the building. So I wanted to walk you through the process of getting in and what the service is going to be like and then getting out, and just give you an idea of what you're in for if you come to our meeting. So if you're parked in the car park here, you'll enter down the ramp here. And as you can see, we have the 2 meter distancing laid out here in case there's queuing. If you're parked out on the street, you can come up this walkway here. And again, the 2 meter distancing is laid out for you. There could be some queuing at the door because it's gonna take a little bit longer getting in, because when you get to the door, Major Cheryl is going to greet you with a pad that is going to have your names listed on it according to your booking, and you have to book ahead of time on this. And so she's going to check off your name, and then she's going to bring you inside. And so again, we have the distancing measured off here. I wanted to point out as we're coming through, this door over here is locked. You won't be allowed to go back in there. Just come on back in here. As we come in here, first off, I wanted to point out that this area is going to be blocked off, and the hallway down here is going to be blocked off. We'll have one toilet in here accessible for use, and that has to be cleaned every time it's used. So at this point, we have face masks that we can give out. If you don't bring your own, we can give out a face mask. Face masks at this time are going to be mandatory. Maybe it'll change by the time the meeting starts, the meeting itself starts, but for now, face masks are mandatory, so either you bring your own or you'll be issued one. You'll be issued this after we usher you to the hand sanitizer, where you'll use that, and then you'll be either given a mask or you'll have your own mask that you can wear in the service. And so then Major Cheryl will bring you in here, and according to your booking, you'll be seated. Now, you can see in here, there aren't a lot of chairs in here, and unfortunately that's the way it is right now. And the chairs are laid out in kind of weird things, in different groupings. And that's because if you book a family of four, you're gonna get four chairs together. If you're just two, then you're gonna get two chairs. If you're one, you'll get one chair. And the chairs will be laid out customized according to the booking that we get before the meeting. And so you come in, Major Cheryl will show you where you can sit. You can't sit just wherever you want. You've got to sit where you're assigned. One thing you'll notice in here is that we're missing the whole band section. And that's because brass music isn't allowed, and we're going to be missing that terribly. For music, we will be able to have piano. We will be able to have recorded music played. That maybe we can have words up on the screen, but you won't be allowed to sing to those words. I suppose you can hum along to the song, but you won't be allowed to sing to the words. But hey, singing in a mask would be uncomfortable, difficult anyway, right? So about all you would want to do is hum with a mask on, which is going to be mandatory. So anyway, our service will go on without the band, without singing. And after the service, you'll be dismissed by row, the back row first. And so after the service, you'll come back this way and you'll be dismissed this way. We will have hand sanitizer at this point to give you a squirt of hand sanitizer as you leave, so you can kind of clean up. And so you'll come out this way, and you'll exit along this path here, around the building, out to the front, and then out and around either to the walkway, to the main walkway, or to the car park, wherever your car is. and you'll be able to head on out that day. So I wanted to let you know what it all looks like so that you can, oh, one other thing here. I saw the camera go over here. The playground is taped off, and I hate to see that. I hate to see a playground taped off, but we can't allow the kids on the play equipment right now. But I wanted to give you an idea, a visual idea of what it's going to look like when we do start up meetings. It's not going to be the same as it was. It's going to be vastly different. And I do that so that you can make an informed choice of whether you want to come or not. You know, we have to discourage over 70s. And it's your choice to come or not to come. But I wanted you to have a means of making an informed decision. And so there you have it. I want to say God bless you and thank you for your attention. What if? Those are two words that most of us have probably used a time or two in our lives. What if? I think of those two words as we've recently completed our risk assessment for our worship service coming up on September 6th. And risk assessments are all about what if. And you've got to try to plan for every single what if there is in a risk assessment. And it's good to consider what ifs, especially in that kind of a setting. You have to really plan for what ifs. You know, in life, what ifs, they can also fuel fear and inaction. They can turn into excuses. God was calling Moses from a burning bush. And if you can just think about that and imagine that, standing in front of a bush that's burning but isn't being consumed by fire, it's just glowing and radiating. And God speaks from that bush. And Moses says, what if? What if? Moses was to be the deliverer. It was the purpose for which Moses was born, to be a deliverer of his people. And God is right now calling him into service, calling him to go and confront Pharaoh. And Moses says, what if? You know, Moses, his excuses may have arisen from past rejection or failure. I mean, he had his down times in the past. He killed an Egyptian soldier. He had good intention, but he killed an Egyptian soldier. So, you know, maybe he was remembering that past failure. But God's question to him in follow-up to Moses' question of what if, God's question was, what is that in your hand? What is that in your hand? It was a simple question. And the answer was simple. It was a staff. It was a staff, a stick. That's what was in his hand. You know, God turns Moses from tomorrow's fear. He brings him to realize the possibilities of today. And we need to face up to today's realities. You know, there's not much we can do about the what ifs of tomorrow. We can plan for those what ifs, but there isn't much we can do about that. But we can do something about the realities of today. It's easy to dwell on tomorrow's problems, isn't it? I mean, in this time, will there be a Great Depression? I used to think, oh, you know, no way. You know, that was all just scare talk or, you know, just people trying to cause trouble, you know, saying things like that. But, I mean, will there be a Great Depression? We don't know. Will I live to see my children grow up? I don't know. Will I live to see my grandchildren grow up? Will I be able to pay my bills? There's a good question, isn't it? So God turned Moses to the one question that he could answer right now. What is that in your hand? And maybe that's what we ought to consider right now. What is that one question we could answer right now, maybe? What is that in your hand? What do you have right now? What do you have to do right now, to work on right now? And there's no excuses for not answering this question. I mean, it was a strange question, kind of, wasn't it? A strange question from God, because God already knew the answer. I suppose this isn't unusual for God to ask questions of people and already know the answer. But certainly this was one example. And it was strange because Moses really just had a stick of wood in his hand, which was a staff. I'm sure it was his shepherding staff that he used with his sheep. He valued that staff. But it was just a piece of wood, really. Moses could think of nothing of value. Moses had that rod in his hand, that staff in his hand. And
God would use that, though. God would use that staff in a mighty way. He used that staff when he had Moses raise the staff at the edge of the Red Sea, and the Red Sea split open, and Israel was able to walk across on dry land. Out in the desert, with a million people out in the desert needing water, that stick brought forth rock, water from a rock. Give what you have to God, and he will use it. Another thing that rod was used for was in Pharaoh's court. When Moses threw down that rod at God's command, and the rod turned into a snake. The magicians did the same, which kind of blows my mind that the magicians were able to throw down their staffs and they became snakes. But Moses' snake then ate up those two, and then Moses reached down, picked it up, and it became a staff again. So again, give what you have to God, and he will use it. The prime example of it. So God's question is the Savior's question. What is that in your hand? What do you have to surrender to Jesus? I know we all have something to surrender to Jesus, unless we're perfect and we have everything already surrendered to him, which I don't think so. But I think we all have things that we could say that we still need to surrender to Jesus. What is that? What is that in your hand? It's the rod of God. And God can use that in mighty ways. And God will do more with what you have than you can. And so, will you surrender all you have to Christ? He will use your talents if you surrender them to him. And if you honestly answer that question of God's, what is that in your hand?